Hello and welcome to Some Assembly Required. This video is to let you know that the 6502 stage of this project is, for all intents and purposes, done. Not that it's completely implemented, we're still missing one tiny feature, but it's good enough for us to move to the next stage, which is to turn this into this. So truth be told, the implementation isn't as small as one might hope. It's about 850 LUTs for the 6502 opcode set and about 920 for the 65CO2 opcode set. It's not terrible. I budgeted for almost twice as that. But it's not as small as Arlett Owen's implementation that is about 250 LUTs. Then again, I can't use this implementation because it's not cycle accurate. So I'll stick with what I have right now. It's probably good enough for this stage of the project. At the later stage, I may have to do something about it and find some way to reduce the number a bit. But for the Apple II, that ought to be enough, and that's what we're moving forward with. At this point, I did not implement all aspects of the CPU. In particular, 6502 has a decimal flag, which means use binary coded decimal. It's a stupid mode that I don't think anyone has ever used. But it's there. And right now, my implementation doesn't do it. It does do such esoteric things as set overflow signal for the CPU, which was only ever used once, as far as I know, but that was in the Commodore 1541, which we will need. So it's there. I've also implemented interrupts, reset cycle, the stop and wait instructions for the Western Design Center's version of the 65CO2, which really nobody used because no 80s 8-bit computer was ever used that particular CPU. It's good enough for now. So first things first, I wanted to go over some details of the implementation I did for the 6502. As you can see, the implementation requires 860 LUTs with 138 flip-flops and just half a BRAM. This is when compiling CPU variant 0, which is the 6502 without the C commands. This isn't 100% compatible, as the 65CO2 has several differences from the 6502, and at this point in time, I'm not implementing those differences. So I'm behaving like a 65CO2 that simply doesn't have some of the commands. I'll definitely circle back to some of them later, but I'm not sure they justify a video. Let me know in the comments. Like I said before, the D flag, the decimal flag, is implemented but not honored, which means that it doesn't actually affect calculation. At this point, that shouldn't be a problem to moving forward. Again, I'll probably circle back to it, but I'm not sure I'll post a video. Let me know if you want to see it. You will notice that the report says that we're failing timing requirements. If we ask to see the path that fails, this isn't particularly readable, but I did manage to figure out where this failure comes from. Looking at the bit opcode, we can see that it does XOR M, which means accumulator XOR memory, and then it sets the Z flag, the zero flag, based on the result. But it also copies the overflow and negative flags directly from memory, which means that we need to load the flags from two different sources. One of them is calculate over the ALU output, and the other is directly copied from memory. The challenge is this. If we look at the instruction in cycle 3500, we see that it's a bit from absolute address. We need one cycle to fetch the opcode, two cycles to fetch the address, and then one cycle to fetch the actual data. Looking at the timing diagram, we see first cycle to fetch the opcode, which is 2C, and then two cycles to fetch the address, which is 1690, and then we fetch from 1690, and at the very end of the cycle, we get the value 6B. At this point, we can still do operations during the fetch cycle of the next instruction, because that's the way I build the CPU. But looking at the data sheet, we see that we actually need to do two operations. One is an ALU operation where we calculate the XOR and get the Z value, and another is a copy of the memory. In order to make that happen, I actually allowed the data in, which is usually latched, to go unlatched into the data bus. So we see that at the very first cycle that the data is available, we set the data bus to be from the memory unlatched, and we say negative and overflow flags are set from the data bus, which gives us another cycle to tell the ALU to do the end operation we need and calculate the Z flag and store it in the flags. So we set the N and V flags here and the Z flag here. But look in the design, what this means is that the data bus can be fed from unlatched memory in. Now, since that only ever happens for the bit command, and since the bit command doesn't write, data out is irrelevant at this point, and this timing violation doesn't actually affect anything. But as far as timing analysis goes, we are in violation. Like everything else, at this point I choose to ignore this. This isn't an actual violation, it's just a potential one, and it doesn't affect us in practice. There's one more thing I wanted to do, which might be interesting. The datasheet I've been working with was published on February 2020. Western Design Center issued a new datasheet dated April 2022. I thought it might be interesting to compare the two and see what changed. I'm going to be using a Linux tool called diffpdf. The first difference is hardly surprising, the publishing date, and also the copyright notice. One more difference that is interesting is the change of URL. They changed it from westerndesigncenter.com to wc656x.com. The old URL is still alive, and strangely, is not identical to the new one. I also noticed that the new URL is considerably slower than the old one. On page 7, you will notice that aside from the URL and the addition of the word page, nothing changed, which is a pity because this page actually had a problem. You will notice this arrow which says that the instruction register pushes to the data bus. That is wrong. The data bus goes into the instruction register. I did bring this to Western Design Center's attention via Twitter, and they said they'll fix it, but they didn't. Bummer. This is another change I'm taking credit for. The old datasheet says that memory lock is low during the last three cycles of arithmetic shift left, decrement, increment, logical shift right, rotate left, rotate right, test and reset memory bit, and test and set memory bit. Which makes sense, because you want to lock the memory while you read, modify, and write. There's only one problem with this. It's not what the CPU actually does. Bit 3 with a value of 4 is on if the memory lock is low, which means active. So we see that it is set for the last cycle of the instruction and the one before that, but not the one before that. You see this last digit here, 1, which means that the memory lock was high. The same is true for the other commands mentioned. Last two cycles, memory lock is low. Third cycle from the end, it is high. I actually brought this to Western Design Center's attention and was met with what I can only describe as disbelief. Turns out they did double check, because the newer datasheet says this. Memory lock is low during the modify and write cycles of the commands. What they're saying is that memory lock is only low during the last two cycles of the instruction, not the last three, which is indeed what the CPU does in practice. However, the 6502 has two more read, modify, write instructions not mentioned in this list. Those are the set memory bit and reset memory bit. Turns out that during set memory bit and reset memory bit, the memory lock is low during the last three cycles of the command. The datasheet never even mentions those commands. I'll also point out that asserting the memory lock only during the last two cycles makes no sense. It, for all intents and purposes, makes the signal unusable. Back to the comparison, we see some formatting fixes that are not that interesting, as well as an amusing spelling mistake. In the addressing mode table, Western Design Center added a comment saying that the break instruction takes 2 bytes, despite the fact that it is only 1 byte. I think we've already discussed in the past the way that break allows another byte that is supposed to say something to the interrupt handler and why that wasn't very useful. This, of course, is not a difference between the versions, but the difference between the annotations I added for all the opcodes I've completed. However, there are differences inside the table. Most of them are just formatting, but opcode B9, load A absolute indexed on Y, was annotated with a capital A by mistake, which is supposed to mean accumulator. Of course, accumulator indexed on Y makes no sense. Same goes for opcode AC, load Y from absolute address, which here was marked as load Y from accumulator. I doubt that actually misled anyone, but it's nice that they fixed it. I really hoped they would add the markers indicating when the bus is invalid, but they didn't. Bummer. Another fix that I doubt actually confused anyone, but it was nice that they fixed it, the arithmetic shift left operator, they indicate that the carry gets initialized from the memory bit 7. It's pretty implicit in the way that the arithmetic shift left is defined as working, but it's still nice that they clarified it. The same goes for the logical shift right and the rotates left and right. They've also added footnotes to this table to make this 100% clear. In the caveats table, they did mostly reformatting, which is strange because they actually screwed up the formatting here. It was actually clearer before. And that about wraps it up. So nothing drastic, obviously, but it's nice to see the things I complained about on Twitter actually made their way into the datasheet as revisions and fixes. So there you have it. Next video we'll be leaving the wonderful world of the 6502 FPGA implementation and moving on to implementing a whole computer. It's not that the work on the 6502 is done, but I think I'll stop boring you with this one particular detail and move on to I think more interesting and more challenging stuff to do. Now, implementing a complete Apple II clone on an FPGA will take several components, that most of which I still don't have, so it will take a while. Then again, I think that by next video I'll be able to show something that works, or at least does something useful, is obviously an Apple II. But that's for next video. In the meantime, thank you for watching and liking. See you next time.